and to be able to celebrate Jesus Christ with each and every one of you this morning. What an opportunity we get to be together in God's house. Amen. I just want to make a special welcome to all of you this morning. If you are visiting with us, maybe this is your first time at Any Creek Church, we are so glad to have you, amen, to be with us today. And if you are a visitor, I hope that you've already received a visitor packet or welcome packet from Brother Gene. Brother Gene was back with us today. Amen. Everybody at the door, but praise God he was able to be there this morning. Amen. Y'all continue to pray for him. But if you receive that welcome packet, visitor packet from Brother Gene, if you'll fill that card out and drop it in our offering in just a minute, boy, we would greatly appreciate that. Amen. And if you've been away from us, maybe you've been sick, or maybe just been on a little vacation, I understand that. We're just glad to see your pretty face back this morning. Amen. But as we get started in service today, let me remind you of a few things that are going on in our church, our up-and-coming announcements. When I said pretty face, I mean it. I hear y'all laughing at me. I did go to the eye doctor to tell me I'm half blind, though. That y'all don't need to know that side, though. Amen. Amen. I want to remind you some things going on in the church. We've got some leftover Vacation Bible School crafts that we're not taking home from Vacation Bible School. They are in the foyer. Today will be the last day that tray, that it sits out there. I promise you they'll be discarded. So if there's any parents or there's any kids in here today that maybe have left some of your stuff, you haven't looked through that, would you please do that? Also, on July the 27th, I believe that is this Friday. Am I right? Is it this Friday or next Friday? It's this Friday. You know it's your birthday, don't you? The 27th of July, the 2nd through 5th grade Sunday school class, they're going to be having kind of a little back-to-school bash. And also, it's going to give the parents a night out from 6 to 12 this Friday. Excuse me, 6 to 12. From 6 to 9. 6 to 9. Amen. If you're not here by 9, your kid will be waiting at the door, I promise you. No, I'm just kidding. But from 6 to 9 this Friday, from 2nd grade to 5th grade, I encourage you, bring your kids, bring the grandkids, let them have a time of fellowship. I promise they will have a great time. And also, that will give you a few hours of a break, maybe as a date night for some of you parents that are in here. Also, today is the last day for our blanket drive. We've been doing a blanket drive for our veterans. Y'all have done an awesome job, but if you have that at home and you haven't brought it in yet, please bring it in by tonight, because tonight will be the cutoff and we'll be turning those in. And also keep in mind that Ink Crink, our women's ministry, will be having a fellowship the second Saturday of the month from 10:30 to 12 p.m. We got some more time to announce that between now and then. But please be remembering all of these things that are up and coming, so that you can be there and be a part of these things. Amen. And please be mindful to be on to continue to pray for those that are on our prayer list, those that are standing in need. We know right now that we may have great needs, but our God is greater, as we were just singing, than those needs. And know that God is able to meet those needs. I want to encourage you that. I want to encourage you especially to pray. And I just share this about Sister Tree Lord. Be praying for Sister Scarlett and Brother Graham. You know, Brother Graham is over in Australia right now. He is right out in the middle of the bush, and she's been sending some pictures to me and just different things that's going on there. God is definitely moving there, but it's a hard life. It's a hard road to hold. Amen. And so continue to uplift their family, the things that they're going on, and her being separated from him. Amen. Continue to pray for them. But at this time, we're going to receive our morning offering, and then we're going to have some more good singing. So if my men would come this morning as we receive our morning tithes and offerings, and I want to encourage you today to just be faithful in your giving, amen. You know what God's blessed you with. You know how well blessed you are, amen. You've got some nice clothes on your back this morning. You've got a car to come here today. You've got shoes on your feet. Wheels got shoes on its feet this morning. You've got a roof. You've got a roof over your head, amen. You had a place to lay your head last night to sleep. God is good, amen. Amen. And so a part of our service right now is that we give back just a portion that God has so freely given unto us. God commands us to give the tithe, amen, to bring the tithes and the offering into the storehouse. It is through that, when you lay that down today, you're saying, God, This is yours already. I know you gave it to me, Lord. And God, in obedience, I'm faithfully just giving that portion back to you that you've required of me. Amen. Let's pray this morning over our offering and over the remainder of this service. Can we today? Heavenly Father, we bow in your presence this morning, and we want to thank you, Lord, from the bottom of our hearts, God, for this week that we have had. Thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to be in your house and worship you in spirit and in truth with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, I've already felt your presence of the Holy Ghost in here this morning. And Holy Ghost, we ask you just to continue to move and minister throughout this service. Touch the remainder of the singing, the special singing. Anoint me as I preach the word today. I pray you prepare the hearts of this congregation to receive the word that's going to be brought forth this morning. Father, now we just come to give back to you, God, our tithes and our offerings. You have so faithfully and freely given to us, God, more than we deserve, God. And so, God, we come to honor you with this tithe and offering, and we ask that you would bless it, Lord, and bless it indeed. I pray, God, that you would help, God, us to continue to grow your kingdom on this earth, right here at Enoch Creek Church, as we reach into this community, God, in this region, and God, even as we send out tithes, or as we send out to missionaries around the world, God, I pray for the blessings on those two, God. In the name of Jesus, we ask and pray it all, and everybody said, amen. Amen and amen. Be faithful in your giving this morning, amen. This morning, Brother Will is going to come and going to bring our special worship this morning. So worship with him today as you give your tithes and offerings.
The song I'm going to sing is it's a song by Michael Tyler. It's probably one of his, maybe it's really, if I'm honest, one of them sings. But it's a beautiful song. It's called Different. And in it, right there in the first part, you know, it says, Lord, help me. I don't want to hear anymore. Teach me to listen. And the thing is, I don't want to see anymore. Give me a vision. And what that brought to mind is Elijah, when they were surrounded and encamped by the enemies. I can't remember what the names were. But they were encamped about by the enemies, and he had with him his servant. He said, what are we going to do? They surrounded us. And then he said, Lord, help him to see. And then at that time, you know, Lord opened his eyes to see that the enemy that surrounded them were surrounded. The mountains around the city were surrounded by angels and chariots of fire protecting them. See, their circumstance was still hard. The circumstance didn't change, but the way they viewed it changed because God helped them to see what was going on, saying that you haven't defeated, you haven't lost, I'm still in control. So have faith and believe that I'm going to see through it because I am powerful. And it's just a beautiful thing. Circumstances change, but my God does.
Thank you.
that chapter, looking at verse, beginning in verse chapter, verse 29. Amen. Let me get my words together this morning. Exodus chapter 4, beginning in verse 29. There. It's good to see you this morning in the house of the Lord. Amen. Aren't you glad today for God's amazing grace? Amen. That He saved you, that He's changed your life. Amen. We're glad Brother Wayne's back this morning. Amen. Appreciate him being back this morning. God, that's good this morning. That's good. On the music. Exodus chapter 4, and we're going to begin in verse 29. Amen. If you'll be looking in your Bibles, it is also on the screen today. Amen. Are you ready? Say amen.
Amen.
And this is what it says. Then Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the children of Israel, and Aaron spoke all the words which the Lord had spoken unto Moses. Then he did the signs in the sight of the people. So the people believed, and when they heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel and that He had looked on their affliction, then they bowed their heads and worshipped. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, "Thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, let My people go, that they may hold a feast to Me in the wilderness." And Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey His voice to let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, nor will I let Israel go." So they said, "The God of the Hebrews has met with us. Please let us go 3 days' journey into the desert and sacrifice to the Lord our God, lest He fall upon us with pestilence or with the sword." Then the king of Egypt said unto them, "Moses and Aaron, why do you take the people from their work? Get back to your labor." And Pharaoh said, "Look, the people of the land are many now, and you make them rest from their labor." So that same day Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people and their officers, saying, "You shall no longer give the people straw to make bricks as before. Let them go and gather straw for themselves, and you shall lay on them the quota of bricks which they made before. You shall not reduce it, for they are idle. Therefore they cry out, saying, 'Let us go and sacrifice to our God.'" Let's stop there this morning and pray over the reading of God's holy word. Heavenly Father, once again we thank You for the time to be in Your house. Thank You for the worship. Thank You for the instrument playing and the special singing. And God, now we want to say thank You for the reading of Your word. Thank You, Lord, for this precious word and this precious book that You have given to us. Oh God, that it may be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. God, there are so many, God, that will not heed its direction, Lord. But I pray, oh God, that You would give us a people and give us a church that have a hunger for this word, to walk in it, to live by it, and to know it and to obey it. God, I pray now as You would help me, God, to bring forth this message. You know the message that You have placed on my heart. I ask for Your anointing, God. I stand in great need of a touch from heaven this morning. I pray that the hearts and minds of our congregation would be open today. And those that are standing in particular bondage, God, You know those that are in strongholds this morning. I pray, God, before they leave here today, all would be surrendered to You. In the mighty name of Jesus, we ask and pray it all. And everybody said, amen, amen and amen. Over the last several weeks, we have been working on the book of Exodus. I did not plan it. It's just something that just kind of happened, and God led me in this direction. And we've been talking about Moses, and we talked about how God delivered Moses out of the Nile River, and how God had called Moses to be a vessel for Him, and that Moses was going to be sent by God unto to Egypt and to Pharaoh and to the Hebrews that were there in bondage. Well, if you'd have been here on Sunday night, I believe we talked about it, how God had to wrestle a little bit with Moses to convince him to go. He gave excuse after excuse after excuse. How many of us can say that we're probably guilty of that when the Holy Spirit deals with us to do something, or we know to do right, but yet we give excuse after excuse after excuse of why we do not do it? But we see this morning in the text that Moses has finally been persuaded by God to go. And God did not send Moses alone, but he sent with him his brother Aaron. And the Bible says that God told him, he says, look, you will go in the, Moses, you're going to go in the place of God. I'm going to put it like he said it. And then Aaron will go in the place of one's going to speak for you. You will tell Aaron what to say. And Aaron will say it because Aaron was more eloquent in speech. And Moses was like, he must have people from South Georgia because he couldn't speak well. Amen. He got tongue twisted and tied. And he had relatives from South Georgia, and I believe particularly Eccles County, amen. And so God sent with him his brother Aaron, who would be the spokesman, who would speak on behalf of him. I think it's kind of funny, amen, that Moses would speak to Aaron, and Aaron would speak unto them. How many of you got, just this though, this is off track a little bit, how many of you got family members, and that you're the only one that can understand them because of the words that they use, amen? I've done that with Daddy. Daddy has certain words that he'll say. I'm about to do. It's bond to rain. Bond to rain. Or it's going to rain, in other words. And somebody said, what did he say? He asked me, what did he say one day? And I said, it's bond to rain. Don't you know what that means? And I said, it's going to rain. Amen. So there's certain people in your life that can only understand you. And I suppose Aaron was the only one that could quite understand Moses. But God sent them down there unto Pharaoh, down to Egypt, to speak to the Hebrew people also. And the message was going to be simple, that Moses and Aaron would deliver unto Pharaoh. It would be simple and it would be to the point. Let my people go. Let's say that together. Let my people go. That was the message. That was what God sent Moses and Aaron down there to do, and down there unto to tell Pharaoh. And the message was easy. The message was easy. It's easy. How many of you know it's easier to say something than it is to do something?
Hey,
oh, yeah. And so we see that in this text, you're going to find out that the message was easy, the saying was easy, but the process was going to be a little bit longer than what it took to say it, amen. The process would be more difficult than actually saying it. Now, you've got to understand something. These people had been living in bondage for 300 years. To put that in perspective today, America is only 241 years old. Amen. In our entirety since 1777, we're 241 years old. They had been in bondage over 300 years. And the Bible says this, that Joseph went down first, we know, and then Jacob, who became known as Israel, would go down. But that generation had died out. The generation that lived when Joseph was prime minister of Egypt, all of them had died out, and all of his generation had died up, and a new generation had come up, and the new generations that had raised up beyond that in the 300 years past them, they never knew what freedom tasted like. Because Pharaoh had placed them in bondage. The Bible says there rose a king that did not know Joseph. And he began to put the Hebrew people in bondage because there were so many of them. He tried to control them through oppression. And the people that we read about today, they had never known freedom. They had never known what it was like to go somewhere without asking somebody. They had never known what it was like to live a life without chains on their feet. They had never known a life where they could do things without asking someone permission. They had been captives. They had been captives from generation after generation. These people were living in what I'm going to call this morning a generational curse. And by that I mean this, that they were slaves. Their parents were slaves, and even to the point that their grandparents had been slaves. Generation after generation had fell captive to the same end, yet the Bible says that God heard their cry, He saw their sorrows, and He desired to deliver them from their bondage. God came down to Moses, and God said these exact words to Moses from the burning bush. He said, I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. God Himself from that burning bush said, I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. As I began meditating on this week, this is not actually the sermon I planned to preach this morning. I was going to preach something else. I'll be preaching it tonight if the Lord wills. But this is what God gave me. As I began meditating and reading over that sermon, over these words, I began thinking about how God still has a desire to deliver those that are in bondage. I said, God still has a desire and a burning in His heart to deliver you from bondage. You may say, Pastor, what kind of bondage are you talking about? I didn't know I was in bondage. I don't have chains on my feet. I came in here free today. What do you mean, Pastor? What kind of bondage? Well, first of all, let me say this. If you have never been saved before, if you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've never been redeemed from your sin, then you are living in the bondage of sin. And the Bible says this, man, makes it very clear that you are a servant of Satan. You are a child of the devil. Did you hear what I said? If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, then you are a servant of Satan. You are indentured unto him. You say, well, no, I'm not. Not me. Well, the Bible says there's no in between.
That's right.
There's no, well, I'm not on God's team and I'm not on the devil's team. I'm just on my own team. It doesn't work like that. The Bible says that there's good and evil, amen. There's right and wrong. There's light and darkness. And you're either walking in the darkness or you're walking in the light. You either know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and you've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, or you are bound to Satan. I want you to know that this morning. That's a generational curse, by the way. Did you know that? I said, that's a generational curse that you have come into sin. What do you mean? The Bible says this, by one man, sin has entered into the whole world. Romans chapter 5, verse 12 says, wherefore, as by one man, sin entered into the world. Thanks a lot, Adam. We get to heaven, if it wasn't for, you know, when we get to heaven, everything's going to be changed and we're going to be made perfect. If not, Adam would probably get beat up when we get to heaven. Amen. They'd be a gang, a mob against Adam, amen. You made me work all these years, amen. But it says, but while one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed, and sin is passed upon all men, for all have sinned. So to speak, if I can say it, it's a generational curse. It's something that is passed down from generation to generation. So we enter into sin, every human being is a sinner. I said, every human being is a sinner. None of us are exempt from that. It's in our blood, amen. It is in the human race. I want you to know that. But this is the thing. Because God has such a great desire to deliver you from that bondage of sin, that He had a great desire to deliver you from that life of death and that death row that you had been living on. Just as God came down in the book of Exodus, Jesus came down in the Gospels and He died a death that you and I could not die. He died and took your place on that rugged cross, standing in the place of death for you and I. And it's through Jesus and Jesus alone that we can be redeemed from the curse of sin. I said it is by Jesus and Jesus alone that we can be redeemed from the curse of sin. I'm going to ask you something. Are you living in bondage to Satan today, or have you been set free by Jesus Christ? I said, are you living on death row and on the way to hell this morning, or are you on the way to eternal heaven because of Jesus Christ? Ain't but two roads, folks. But I want to share something else with you that God laid on my heart about this text this morning. Something that had been heavy on my heart. And I just began, it's amazing how whenever you get to a place, I have found Brother George or Brother Wayne or anybody else in here that teaches Sunday school or teaches, preaches, whatever the case may be, I have found when you get to a point at a roadblock in your mind and God's not, doesn't seem to be opening up anything, if you'll just take a little break, amen. If you'll just walk away from it for just a few minutes and don't put your mind on anything else, and maybe just put your mind on God, you know what I found? Eventually, shortly, God will start speaking to you. And so I got frustrated the other day because I wasn't sure where God wanted me to go with this message. And about this point, I walked away from it, and I came in here. I was sitting right here on this pew, just sitting there quiet. And just began to thinking, and God began to deal with my heart about some things. And I began to write them down, and I want to share it with you this morning. Just as we live under this generational curse of sin, that every human being, the Bible says, we have all fallen short of the glory of God. We've not met His standard. But I also want to share with you some other bondages and some curses, if you will, that God began speaking into my heart about this week. Because I believe that there are Christians, there are born-again believers that have strongholds in their lives, because that there are some strongholds in their lives, also because for certain reasons, several different reasons, but I believe some of them are generational curses. I said, I believe that there are people that live in bondage. I'm talking about Christian people, born-again believers that want to desire to walk in complete freedom, but yet also they struggle with curses that are in their life. What are you talking about, Pastor? What do you mean, Pastor? There's a struggle inside of you and in your life, and it's the same struggle that maybe one of your parents had, that one of your a grandparents had, or that an uncle had, or that somewhere in your family tree also had. I preached this a little while back about generational curses on a Wednesday night. And I talked about how the devil, and I believe that there are spirits that can set themselves up in a family tree, and they will go from one generation to the next generation to the next generation. I know right now of a family right now, not connected to this church, but they know they can go back and they can point out four generations of drunkards in their family. There's a spirit of drunkenness that runs through that family. There was a young boy that I was talking to one time, and he was telling me about this, about his daddy, and then about his grandpa, and about his great-grandpa, were all drunks. And I said, let me tell you something, son, I'll tell you right to your face. If you ever pick up that alcohol, the devil is going to latch onto you like a junkyard dog with a bone, and he ain't going to let go. I said, because that's a stronghold that runs in your family. And we've got to understand that there are certain strongholds that run in generations. There are certain strongholds in spirits that run in family trees, whether you want to believe it or not. And there's some that struggle. Maybe they struggle with alcohol. Maybe they struggle with lust or pornography. They struggle with being deceivers. Deceivers. Liars. Liars. Anybody struggle with being a liar in here this morning? Amen. I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. Anybody remember the story of Jacob? The story of Jacob? Jacob was a deceiver. Jacob was a liar. Do you know what? His mama was also a liar and a deceiver. Not only was his mama a liar and a deceiver, his uncle was a liar and a deceiver. Understand, there's certain spirits that can set up in strongholds that can establish themselves in family trees. We see this in the Hebrews. Mama was a slave, daddy was a slave, grandpa was a slave, and it kept going through the generation. Every generation came to the same end. From generation to generation, they came to the same end. There's some of you in here this morning that are serving the same masters of those that came before you did. You've got these strongholds that you've been wrestling with, and you have a desire to be free, but nothing has happened yet. But God spoke into my heart this week as I sat right here on that front pew as I was praying unto God. I want to share with you right now, if you are living in these strongholds, I want to encourage you and tell you this morning, your deliverance is on the way. Listen to me right now. You are struggling in some strongholds in your life right now. You've been trying to break free, and you just keep looking back and you say, well, my whole family's that way. Mama done this. Daddy done that. Grandpa done that. I'm not going to be anything different. I've got to come by here this morning and tell you that there is a way that you can be set free. You can walk in the freedom that Jesus had for you this morning. Just because your family's that way, just because you come from that rough path, doesn't mean that's who you are today. And so many times we get caught up in that and we think, I'm never going to be anything else but what they used to be. Well, that's not true. Because we serve a God, amen. I said we serve a God that can break every stronghold in your life. But now I want to share with you the other part that God began to speak to my heart about. And they said that your deliverance is on the way. Why don't you say that with me? Your deliverance is on the way. But God also began to deal with my heart as I began praying that the other morning. He also said this, it's going to be a process. Woo! He said it's going to be a process. What do you mean, Pastor? In other words, it's going to take just a little bit of time. Mm-hmm. It might take a little bit more time than you think it will or that you want it to. I mean, you know, God never works fast enough for any of us, amen? For us, God should have worked yesterday, amen, for the most part. God said, God was speaking in my heart. He said, I will deliver them, but it's going to take a little time. What do you mean by that, Pastor? And I began reflecting on this passage of Scripture. I began reflecting on this of what we see as Moses went down and he began to speak unto Pharaoh. When he spoke to Pharaoh, as we read this morning, and he went down there and he said, let my people go. Pharaoh didn't say, okay, I'm done. Go ahead, you can have them. But the Bible says that he began to put more on the backs of the Israelites and the Hebrews, and he began to put more work upon them. Do you know, if you study this, it took about a year before they actually walked out of Egypt. It wasn't the next day, but it was a process, Brother Wayne. God had to work some things out in the Egyptians and also in the slaves, the Hebrews themselves, before he delivered them. I want to share a few things that God pointed out to me from this text today. Can I do that for real quickly? Your deliverance is coming, but it might take a little longer than you expect. Number one is this. I want to share with you. First of all is this about your deliverance. About being set free from a generational curse or any stronghold that is in your life right now. Can I tell you something? The first thing is this. You must believe that there's a better life. First of all, you must believe there's something better. You must believe that there is freedom. You must believe that you don't have to live the way that you have been living. Just because daddy and grandpa or grandma done it, it doesn't mean there's not hope for you. Amen. Because there is. Until you believe it, you'll never have that opportunity to be set free. You must believe that you don't have to continue in the same state of life in bondage. You must believe that there is better for you. Do you believe that today? Amen. Why do I say that, Pastor? Why do you bring that up that I must believe? I must get it in here. Why must I believe that God can change my life? Why must I believe that He can set me free from curses that other people never got broke free from in my life? I want to share this with you. Look here at the beginning of these verses. It says this, that Aaron, in verse 30, says, and Aaron spoke to all the words which the Lord had spoken to Moses, and they did the signs in the sight of the people, so the people believed. When Moses and Aaron went down to Egypt, notice they did not go to Pharaoh to start with. They didn't go straight to Pharaoh, but they went to the Hebrews who were in bondage. They didn't go straight to the taskmaster, the one that was over them and putting them in bondage. But first they went to the one that was in bondage. Why? Because if they could not get them convinced that God wanted to deliver them, there was no need in going to the one that was holding them captive. I said, until they got it in their heart that God wanted them to be free, there was no need in going over here and saying, hey, let my people go. They had to believe and get it in their heart that God wanted them to be free and had a better life for them, and that God was able to do it. Moses and Aaron went to them to begin with and began sharing with them the word of God to start with, it says. Wow. It says he began speaking all of the words that God had shared with them. If you have got a generational curse in your family, or if you've got a stronghold in your life today, let me encourage you to pick up the Word of God and begin digesting it and putting it in your spirit, because you will find promise after promise in this Word that God wants you to be free. That God does not want you to live under captivity. That He does not want you to live in a way that is controlling your life. Do you know what? We can go ahead and just give you one right here from Genesis. You know what? When God created Adam and Eve, He said, I give you the world. He said, I give you dominion over all things. I give you dominion over all things. That it was the created order of things. All of the plants, all of the animals, all the birds of the air. He said, you have dominion over them things. They are controlled. You are to control them. They're not to control you. How many of you know it? We get to a place where we allow worldly things, though, to control us. Mm-hmm. the order's out of line. Amen. Your order's out of line. God never meant for worldly things to control you. But you are to rule over those things. Amen. You are to have control over those things. But we've got to believe today that there is something better today. Moses went forth and told them of the Word of God. If you've got a stronghold in your life, let me encourage you to pick up that Word of God. You want to know another reason why? Because the Word of God, the truth of God, it defeats every lie that the devil has sold you over the years.
Yes.
I said the truth of God's Word defeats every lie that you have been listening to for the last 20 years and saying you'll never change, you'll never be free, nothing's ever going to happen for me. Let me tell you something. The Bible dispels every lying and deceiving spirit that comes against your thoughts and your mind. Ooh, that was, y'all were weak.
Yes.
Come on now. I'm up here sweating like a pig and y'all just sitting there in the air conditioning this morning. I'm trying to tell you what God put on my heart today. You, some of you letting the devil lie to you, amen, and you got the Word of God to know the difference between lie and truth.
Amen.
Listen to the truth, amen. Moses shared with them what God said, and it brought them to faith. Mm-hmm. I said, he shared what God said, and it brought them to faith. Let me tell you something, it'll do the same thing for you this morning. You read the stories of this Word of God today, it will bring faith in your life. Whoo, there's something better for me. The second thing that Moses did when he went into the Hebrew people, he told them what God said and it brought faith. But the second thing he did is he gave them signs. Now, I am not going to take a rod and turn it into a snake this morning, okay? You know, if I could, I might be pretty cool. I might do it on the front row up here if y'all could handle it, amen. Sister Elena might grab it by the tail if it did. But you know what I got to thinking about? I got to thinking about signs. Well, God, what is a sign? Think about this for just a minute. Moses showed them signs and they brought faith. They believed. Signs. Something they could see. An example of what God can do. Very simply. A sign was an example of what God can do. And I got to think, well, God, what is that for the church today? What kind of signs that have you given for the church today? And I got to thinking about it. I got to thinking about all the testimonies that we have heard just in this church about how people have been set free from alcohol and drugs and other addictions that are in their lives and other things of their mind. You know what? I got to thinking those are signs unto the people. Those are signs unto the people. When you begin to sharing with somebody about what God has done in your life, and how you give glory to Jesus for setting you free. Do you know what? That might just be the sign that they needed to believe, hey, Jesus can do it in my life.
Yes.
Can I tell you something? If God can do it for Danny, he can do it for anybody. Amen? Yeah. He can do it for Carol. He can do it for anybody.
Woo!
He can do it for Rosie. He can do it for anybody. If my God can do it for you, he can surely do it for you. When you begin to share the testimony, and you don't have to be on a stage to share your testimony about what Jesus has done for you, but when you just begin to share what God has broke off of your life, how He's changed your life, maybe in Walmart, you know them people in Walmart need salvation. Glory to God. Tell the people in Walmart what Jesus has done for you. Amen?
Amen.
Woo! Glory! Begin to share. Lord have mercy. I was in Walmart the other night about 10 o'clock. And I remember the reason I never go to Walmart. I told somebody when I left, I'm going to wash my eyes whenever I leave here. Amen. Lord, I had to walk around like this in Walmart. Woo, Lord, have mercy. You know them people need salvation. Glory to God. Why are you waiting in that line? You know, because they only have two cash registers open.
Amen.
And about 100 people there. Just go and find somebody to tell Jesus about. Amen. While you're standing there. Be a sign to somebody. Hold that sign. You know what it says? Jesus. Amen. Jesus did it. Amen. Jesus saved me. Jesus delivered me. Jesus healed me.
Woo!
And he can do the same thing for you today. Give God praise. That says, God can do it for you too.
Mm-hmm.
God can do it for you too. He can do it for you too. Now, something else God began dealing with my heart about this text. And man, if you'll put Exodus back up there, the beginning verses of chapter 5. Well, another thing After we get it in our heart and our mind, and I believe, and we begin to hear these testimonies, we hear the Word of God, and faith and hope begins rising up in our hearts that yes, God can change us. Yes, God can set us free. How many of you have ever been there before? And you get excited.
Yes.
Yeah. Ooh, come on now. I said you get excited and you get pumped up because you just know, oh, my deliverance is fixing to come tomorrow. Something's fixing to break. Something's fixing to change. And you get all excited.
Yes, amen.
And then the next step, yes, all hell breaks
loose.
How many, can I just use this example? How many, every time you say, I'm going to go on a diet. I'm going to go on a diet. I'm going to lose 20 pounds. The next day, somebody will show up with work with 2 dozen donuts. Amen. Woo! How many of you know that works like that? Every time when you say, I feel it. I know God wants this different for me. I'm fixing to make some changes in my life. I'm fixing to do this or I'm fixing to do that. And it just seemed like all hell seemed to want to break loose. When you get to praying, you get to believing, you get to making the needed changes in your life to shut the door on temptation and the devil, it just seems like the devil comes in just like a flood against you, doesn't it? You know what? You need to love this. Number two, many times things will get worse before they get better. You need to understand that. I want you to believe and know that God can save you, but I also need you to understand this now. You get that in your mind. You start walking in that faith, believing that God's fixing to break free, break the chains off your life. Let me tell you, things is going to get worse before they get better.
Amen.
Why do you mean that? Think about old Moses. Think about Moses. He went down there after he convinced the people, you're going to be free. God's going to deliver you. He shared the word. He shared the signs. He goes down there to Pharaoh next, and he says, let my people go. Well, Pharaoh didn't say, well, how you doing, Moses? I'm glad to see you came. I'm glad you're telling me about this Lord and everything. No. He said this. He said, who is the Lord? I'm the most powerful man around here. He said, I tell you what, because you're telling me all of this, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to heap more work on the Hebrews. And instead of giving them straw, they're going to have to go rake their own straw to make the bricks. And they're going to have to still make the same amount of bricks that I started with. He didn't make everything better. It got worse. When you begin to make up your mind that you're going to have freedom in your life and that you're coming out hell or high water, you're going to have to walk through hell because that devil's going to do everything that he can to stop you. He's going to do everything that he can to keep you in that same state that you're in right now. Because he doesn't want to get you free. As long as we'll sit still, and we'll allow him to keep us locked up and in chains and in bondage on our hearts and our minds. Do you know what? The devil will just keep riding his mind. But you go start going against the stream. You try and go against the stream and against the flow and against him. Oh man, that's when the battle starts.
Amen.
I said, that's when the battle starts. And you know that's where a lot of people get discouraged.
Yep.
People will go and we'll shout about it and we'll say, God's about to deliver you. God can deliver you. We begin to believe it. We get excited about it. We know that Holy Ghost can power can do it. But then all hell will break loose the next day. You need to understand. Tomorrow, I'm just going to go in and warn you this morning. I believe we're going to have an altar call in a minute. I believe God's going to do a work. But do you know what? You might as well get ready for a battle tomorrow. Things many times will get worse before they get better. You know what? When Moses first told the Hebrews, he showed them these signs. You know what? They thought, I believe they just thought they was going to snap, walk out of there. I believe that them Hebrews, after he went and told them, that they thought too, that, hey, it's just going to be a snap. We're just going to walk right out of here tomorrow. Once he goes to Pharaoh that one time, that's it. We're going to leave this place. With just a snap of the fingers. But you know what? It didn't work out that way. They stayed there almost another year. They were in Egypt another year before they departed. It was a process, listen to me, that they had to go through before things happened. And the thing is, listen to me, in that time of waiting, and do you know what happened? The people began to get frustrated. They knew that God could do it. They heard the word. They seen the signs. But when God didn't just do it like that, and things became worse instead of better when Moses first went to Pharaoh, do you know that the people became frustrated? And the Bible says that they went unto Moses. We didn't read this part, but they go unto Moses, and they start to complain and take out all their frustration on him, and say, "Hey, you ain't doing us no favors. You're making things worse for us." Listen. When things in your life don't go as easy as you plan them to, when you are struggling trying to break out and there's turmoil in your heart, do you know what many times we will do? We will lash out at somebody that we love. We will lash out at the people that are trying to help us. We will lash out at those who care about us. And even we'll get to a point we'll begin to blame God. You go to studying this story, when everything didn't go as easy as they thought it was going to go, they began to blame Moses. And guess what Moses done? Moses turned around and blamed God. He says these very words at the end of chapter 5. He says, "Why have you brought this trouble on Israel?" There's some people right here in here tonight, this morning, may be blaming God for your situation. Maybe you're angry with your spouse or your parents because of your situation. You're angry with God because things haven't begun to change. You get up mad every morning at the world. I want to encourage you this morning to think how your actions are affecting those around you. If you don't stop it right now, I'm going to tell you something. You're going to lose those ones that love you and are trying to help you. Listen to me. Sometimes there are certain things that God uses the process of time to deliver you from. I said there are certain things in life that God uses the process of time to deliver you from and through. And many times we think, well, we're just supposed to pray one time and we're going to walk out of it. But God wanted me to share with you this morning that sometimes it's a little bit more difficult than that. Well, why, Pastor? Why? Why though? Why can't he just do it instantly? How many of you know I've seen God do it instantly? Amen. At the same time, I've seen those same people though that they struggled with 20, 30 years before God touched them. You say, "Well, why God, I just can't come pray one time and it be just instantly and I leave and I be done. Why do I have to struggle? Why do I have to go through these nights of crying and fighting and praying?" I want to share with you why. Right here we see it in Exodus chapter 6. He says, "I am the Lord." Exodus chapter 6, verse 2 and 3. Listen, "And God spoke to Moses and said to him," after Moses began grumbling and complaining, the people were mad, Moses is mad. Moses says, "Why you sent me down here?" This was God's response. After Moses said, "Well, why ain't this easy?" God spoke to Moses and said to him, "I am the Lord." King James is capitalized, L-O-R-D. And right there, if you go back to the original, it just simply, we say Yahweh. Anybody ever heard Yahweh before? Right here where it comes in at. "I am Yahweh. I appeared to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob as God Almighty. But my name, the Lord, was not known to them." He said, "I told them I was God Almighty." He said, "But I am revealing unto you more of myself than has ever been known to anyone else." I want you to get that in here this morning. Amen. He had told Moses. He said, "I'm going to deliver you. I'm going to set the Hebrew people free. Yes, it's going to take a little bit of time, but through the process of time, I'm going to reveal myself unto you in a way that you have never dreamed nor imagined." And the reason some of you are going through this process of time with the struggle that you are going through, can I tell you something? God wants to reveal more of Himself unto you in the midst of that struggle than you've ever seen before. Why, oh, this just come to my heart. Why is it that God would keep us in a struggle longer to see more of Him and reveal Himself more clearer than anything else? Why would God keep us in a struggle? Why would God allow time to pass and us to keep struggling and use that time to reveal Himself more to us? Why? Because when everything's going good, you won't listen. That's right. Oh, yeah, come on now. God just dropped, that's one from the Holy Ghost, because He just dropped it in my heart right there. When everything's going good, you won't listen, my friend. to do that. You've got to pray. But when all hell's against you, oh Lord, I'm ready to listen, God. I'm ready to pray, God. Woo! Come on now. Sometimes God allows us to go through the struggle for a season that He may reveal more of His glory to us. Sometimes He'll hold you there a little longer than you want Him to. He'll use the process of time to deliver you because He wants you to know Him more. I've seen it too many times. I've seen people on their deathbed pleading with God, if God had just healed me, I'd be in church every Sunday. I've seen God just raise them up off their deathbed. Should have been dead. Come to church two times and you never see them again.
That's right.
God will let us linger because God wants to speak to us.
Yes.
And sometimes the only time that God can speak to us is when we bow a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we're running and we're doing what we want, we forget to listen. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for that right there. Thanks. If you ain't got nothing else, I hope you got that this morning. If not, you better rewatch that. I'm going to rewatch that. That's good. That's good, Lord. Woo! He wants you to know more of Him. God wants you to know Him more personally. And so my word is this unto you. If you're in the midst of that struggle right now and you're just waiting on God to break, man, the chain, I encourage you to press in. Keep pressing in. Keep holding on to God. You might be in a place right now you're about to give up. Just want to say, well, I'm just going to quit. I'm just going to just give in to my struggle. I'm going to give in to that sin. I'm just going to do it. It's easier. Yeah, it is easier. But I encourage you to press in to God right now. Let me look at one more scripture real quick. Hold on and press in. He promised to deliver the Hebrews. Look at Exodus chapter 6, verse 6. Therefore, I'm about done. Just hold with me a few more minutes. Therefore, say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord. I am Yahweh. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage. And I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great judgments. I will take you as my people, and I will be your God. Look, but then you shall know that I am the Lord, your God, who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. Woo! Amanda, will you back out? Back up to the beginning of the first six right there. Therefore I say unto the children of Israel, I am the Lord. He is Yahweh. I will. Everybody say, I will.
I will
bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians or your oppression, your struggle. Everybody say, I will.
I will
rescue you from their bondage. Everybody say, I will.
I will
redeem you with an outstretched arm and the judgments. And let's say, I will.
I will
take you as my people and I will be your God. Woo, hallelujah. I'm going to take you through what you're going, what you're battling, what you're facing, what's been holding on to you. He says, I am going to go with you through it. And when you come out on the other side, you're going to know that I did it.
Mm-hmm.
When you come out on the other side of this struggle that you've been going through, when you come out, you're going to know I am the Lord.
Amen.
You know what I've seen before? Sometimes if things happen quickly, we just say to somebody, I've seen this, somebody's sick. We pray and God does heal and raise them up. They begin giving the credit to the doctor or giving the credit to the medicine or giving the credit to them. You know what God's saying? He said, I'm going to hold you there just a little longer. And when I bring you out, you're going to know nobody else done it. It wasn't Moses' eloquent words as he was reasoning with Pharaoh or Aaron. It wasn't to any kind of leverage, but it was with my power. It was by my hand, my mighty, it says, outstretched arm, I will redeem you. Nothing else. Let me tell you something. When God brings you out, you won't give the glory to a meeting, an AA meeting, or any type of other meeting, or a church. You're going to give the glory to God.
Amen.
You'll give the glory to God. Amen. Glory to God. I'm closing. God's got a promise. He'll deliver you. If you're a sinner in here today, you've never accepted Jesus Christ, God has a promise for you. He'll deliver you. Do you know that? What do you mean, Pastor? Where do you see? Where do you know that? He'll deliver me. Because the Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you call on Him, He'll hear you. I said, let me tell you something. If there is a prayer that God will not turn down, it's a prayer to receive salvation. He hears that prayer. And if you've never prayed and asked Jesus to come into your heart, I'm imploring you. I plead with you. Do it this morning. I encourage you this morning that there's a struggle going on in your life right now. Whether it's an addiction, whether it's a stronghold, maybe it's something that your family members have struggled with and now it's passed down to you. I want to encourage you to believe and you know that God can set you free. You've got to get it in your heart and your mind that God is the way maker and God is the chain breaker.
Amen.
But don't just think it's going to be just, oh, I won't never have to struggle no more. I won't never fight. You've got to be willing to fight. Because things will get more difficult as you go along. But if you'll hold on and press in, do you know what? You will find more of God's grace and more of God's glory and more of God's mercy. And you will see God in a whole new way when you come out on the other side. That song that we were singing earlier, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, and I once was lost, but now I'm found. And then the next part says this, I now can see clearly. Oh, I can see you now. I can see the love in your eyes, laying yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Do you know what? In the midst of our struggles, sometimes we don't see that grace. We don't see God's mercy. And we wonder, where is God? Why hadn't God showed up? Why hadn't God set me free? Why hadn't God just changed this situation? But all the while, God is busy working on your behalf. God is moving in your situation. God is bringing you through some things. There are certain things in life that are a process. I have learned that. But then when you come out on the other side, you begin to see clearer. You begin to see, oh, God was there all the while. I see His love. I see His patience. I see, whoo, He was doing something to bring me out. Amen. Glory to God. I encourage you, if you want to go along with something I'm preaching this morning, go watch that movie called I Can Only Imagine.
Amen.
If you haven't seen it. But we see the same thing happen in this young man's life through his father and things that happened to him. But God was just using all of his past to bring him to one point in his life. Trust God right now. Wherever you are, whatever you're struggling with, whatever you're going through, my last words is this. Trust God. I am the Lord. Will you stand up all over the house? As we close, nobody's leaving, nobody's moving around for just a minute. Just stand up. I want to ask you this. I'm surely not going to get you to come here and tell me all about it. As we close and we're going to sing, you say, I've got some struggles in my life. I've got some strongholds in my life. Pastor, man, you was hitting, the Holy Spirit was hitting some words this morning, hitting my heart today. Then I want to encourage you with all that I am to get out of that altar. Get out of that altar. Get out of that pew, amen. And get in the altar, amen, this morning. I want to do something different. Can I do this? If God's dealing with your heart right now, and you just say, I need special prayer this morning. You ain't got to tell me what it is. I don't want to know. But I'm struggling this morning, Pastor. I want to be free. If you're struggling with something, would you come stand across the front of this aisle? If there's one or if there's two, if you say, I've just got some struggles going.